Hare Krishna. Impulse may run over our intelligence, but don't let it take over our intelligence. Sometimes a formidable army attacks a force and attacks so fort so forcefully that the defense is overwhelmed, and that army runs in and plunders the city. But many times a plundering army cannot possess the city for long because the resistance within the city becomes very strong. And then often that invading army makes some kind of alliance, plunders, imposes some terms, and then withdraws, goes away, because they don't have the resources to rule. However, if this invading army can win over, can tempt and convert some of the rulers in the ruling party, in the fort, to become its subordinate, to become its servant, then the invading party's rule becomes permanent. So similarly, in our case, if we consider our consciousness to be like a fort, sometimes the invasion of impulse, of some sensual desire, may be so forceful that it may overrun our consciousness. And at that time, our intelligence may just not be able to defend. We may find that despite our knowing that we should not do something, still we end up doing that thing. Krishna talks about this problem in 2.60 when he says that yatato yapi kaunteya purushasya vipaschitaha indriyani pramathini haranti prasabham manaha, that the senses are so strong and impetuous that they may carry away the mind of even a person of discrimination who is endeavoring to control them. So the defending army is trying to defend, but they are overwhelmed. So like that, our intelligence may be overrun by impulse. At the same time, the impulse shouldn't be allowed to take over our consciousness. That means when impulse arises, say somebody gets an urge to drink alcohol and they just can't resist it, drink, and they give up. But suppose after that people start rationalizing, saying that actually drinking alcohol is very good, what's wrong with it? And they come up with various kinds of concocted reasons to continue drinking it. And what has happened? Their intelligence has not only been run over, but taken over. Now they are using the intelligence to defend the impulse rather than to defy and drive out the impulse. So if we nourish our intelligence regularly by studying the Bhagavad-Gita, then our intelligence will be strong enough to fight against impulse. And even if that impulse temporarily overpowers us and we indulge in some wrongdoing, instead of being disheartened by that, after that lapse, we can immediately resume our connection with Krishna. We study the Bhagavad-Gita, pray to Krishna, focus our consciousness on Krishna, and thus our intelligence will become restored and rejuvenated. And with that intelligence, we can beat back impulse. And this is what Krishna recommends in the Bhagavad-Gita's 3rd chapter, 43rd verse. Evam buddhe param buddhva samsthabhyatmanam atmana jahi shatrum mahabaho kamarupam durasadam. So with intelligence, Krishna says, focus on transcendence, situate yourself in transcendence, and thus overcome the great enemy of self-destructive impulse. So by recognizing that our intelligence may sometimes be defeated, but it doesn't have to defect over to the impulse. And that we can prevent by firstly avoiding getting discouraged by the defeat, and avoiding letting the defeat disconnect us from Krishna. So if we stay connected with Krishna, then we can beat back impulse, and gradually by that connection with Krishna will become purified enough that we will be able to protect the fort of our consciousness from impulse entirely, becoming purified and satisfied, being absorbed in Krishna. Thank you. Hare Krishna.